Good morning, Tahoe Community Church. I'm over here at the piano, if you can't find me. We're going to start service with a song called Great Things. God has done great things. Please stand.
Amen. Amen.
Yeah.
Who do we have on announcements this morning?
Ted, I believe.
Okay, who has announcements? It's a table.
Jeff.
Oh,
Jeff's not here.
Here comes
Leonard. Here we go. My name is Jeff Brumbaugh.
Good morning.
Welcome.
Hey, Jeff, stay on
Sunday.
Point, brother.
What's that?
Stay on point, brother.
There you go. Gotta move around. That's what Jeff does.
He's, love you, Jeff.
Yep.
Love you, Jeff.
He's in Southern California right now, seeing his mother-in-law. So, pray for safe passages for him. Do I have this on?
No. Scoot right. That's not on. You need to get in front of the
camera. Well, Jeff would be on camera anyhow, so see if I would do this. So anyway, we have some announcements. If you're visitors, you can fill this card out for us. If you would, on the back side, there's a prayer request, and we do pray for you all. And let's see, what else do we have here? Okay, so next week, Easter Day, there will not be a 9 o'clock Sunday school class. Was that agreed upon?
Yep. Yes.
Okay. So we'll have some snacks over there and some fellowship time. There will be a prayer time. It's going to move till 9:30. Okay. So there will be some prayer time at 9:30 for all who want to be involved. Let's see, we've got Zoomerang coming for VBS this June. So there's signups there, probably in the back.
Yeah, we still need some teachers and some helpers, so if you can help.
Teachers and helpers.
Yeah, more help.
And kids too. So if you know some kids, bring them along.
Yeah.
So I see here an urgent need. Oh, we need some urgent need for help with the younger children during church service.
Yep.
So if you'd like to be involved with that. Let's see, and then, National Day of Prayer, mark this down, May 5th. That'll be coming up real soon. Let's see, did I miss anything?
Friday
service, Good Friday, yes. Jeff Brumbaugh. He will be here by then. And Jeff is going to be giving the sermon. Bob and I will be out of town. So,
5 p.m.
So Jeff's got Friday and Sunday. So pray for him. And it's always fun to watch Jeff in the pulpit. So you've learned quite a bit. So let's see. Oh, and let's pray for continued prayer for the pastor's search committee and finding the right pastor to lead the elders and the deacons. And there's a lot of people here that do a lot. So we thank them for that. And if you want to be involved, hey, let us know. We can find out what spiritual gifts you have and how you like to serve. So, okay. Let's see, what else? Anything else? Okay. Well, I usually forget something, so during the offertory, I'll probably. Wednesday, yes. Brad West will be doing the Wednesday prayer meeting. So, or not prayer meeting, but the Wednesday Bible study. So, will you join me in prayer? Heavenly Father, we just come before you and we just give you thanks for who and what you are. And may our hearts just rise up and say, Hosanna, 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 Hosanna in the highest. We thank you, Father, for your Son, Jesus, who gave us so much in his dying on the cross. We thank you for that, that gift of grace, that gift of reconciliation. And it's just to be redeemed, and that's so important. Father, we just thank you for this time together. May our praises be a pleasant aroma to you, and may you be with Bob. May your spirit dwell upon him, and Give them the right words to say, and may our ears be able to hear, and may we glean something and put it into practice within our lives this next week. We thank you and we love you. In Jesus' name, amen.
If you would please rise, we're going to sing Hosanna, Praise is Rising.
This be a good song to wave your palm branches on.
Anybody who's got palm branches? Can you turn my guitar on?
Can we raise our hands too if we don't have a palm branch?
Yes!
Yes!
Somehow we ran out of sound.
We lost juice. Hold please.
We lost juice. 13?
Yeah,
that's a lot.
Okay.
Okay, it's going to be acoustic. Everybody play quiet.
We're testing grace today.
We're testing grace. We said it all the morning. We're testing grace today. All right, we're going to play Hosanna, Praise is Rising. Katie, can you check in the back, too? Okay, here we go. 1, 2, 3, 4.
Thank you.
earlier, so I just confessed my sin in church. That's very powerful.
Very powerful. Very powerful.
Amen, brother.
You're forgiven.
Thank you.
You are alone, and I will not. in the morning. When I rise in the morning, when I rise, give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. You can't have all this good. Just give me Jesus. When I
in the back by the windows back there, and if you are so inclined, please give to this ministry. So I was just thinking, you know, we're so unprofessional. Besides the group up here, they're professionals.
No,
but
no, we're not.
you sound like you're down there.
Thank you.
So anyway, things happen. Things happen here, like who's the service leader? Whoops, that fell through the cracks. Whoops, this fell through the cracks. Oh my. So sometimes we don't seem like we're that professional or it goes so smoothly, but we do it in a loving way. And it all gives us a chance to forgive one another. Amen. And what a group of people here. We have forgiven each other more times than I have toes and fingers. So it's a good group to be around to make mistakes with. So I'm going to read one of my favorite psalms. It's Psalm 100. Kind of an easy one to remember. It's short. It's sweet. And it's to the point. And so maybe this might resonate with you. Psalm 100. Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs. Know that he is the Lord. Pardon me. Know that the Lord is God. It is he who makes us, and we are his.
Where are his people? The sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name. For the Lord is good and his love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations. Please pray with me. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for how you provide for this church and for the many hands that work so hard around here. We thank you, we love you, and we just thank you for, for provisions, for jobs, for health, for healing, for our loved ones, for family members, for safe travels, for being able to live in this area, and for your creation that you've surrounded us with, and may it be mindful for us to remember that you created it with just your voice. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name, amen.
Oh, we're gonna,
the kiddos?
Yep.
Okay. I was gonna forget, but then, sit down, so I got time. So the kiddos are dismissed, and we have Brother Bob up here, and he's gonna give the sermon.
Good morning, talk communities. How are we doing today?
Good.
Like when Leonard talked about grace extended to each other and stuff. My father was quite cynical and had a wicked sense of humor, and some of it rubbed off on me. So, I would love to get to know you well enough so I can be snarky to you. And then I can apologize, like I apologized to Mike Furno in the Bible study today. Him and I went rounds and we had some fun snarkiness. It gets you in trouble, though. You wonder about comedy and God and how it fits in the kingdom. He's given us a sense of humor, for Pete's sakes. I mean, after all, look at me. It's just, obviously, it's a funny thing. But nonetheless, the grace to extend each other that Leonard referred to is abounds in this body of believers. So get to know us well enough that we can offend you and then forgive you, and then forgiveness, right? Because I think that's a big part of you know if you remember the early church, soon as they got the freedom given to them once Rome made Christianity an official religion, there was peace and time to do silly things like be a monk on top of a mountain. Well, how are you going to love your neighbor, and how are you going to be able to interact in love if you go up on a mountaintop? Does that make sense? It made sense. It's like how I can love God up here. I look really good on top of a mountain away from all these people that irritate me. Amen? But God's called us for communal life, where we're a community, where we rub off on each other, and sometimes we offend each other. But we know from Scripture, the command to forgive is just so powerful. You know, it's a downright command with the stipulation if we don't forgive, then God won't forgive us. And so just doing a little extra preaching here now that I was sidetracked by Leonard, you won't find that in the notes today. But it's one of those key things that this little body of believers is really good at it. So welcome, everybody. If you're visitors, I have my disclaimer. Once again, I say if you're coming here, you got to give us 3 tries before you decide this isn't a church for you. So you got to give us a couple more tries if this is your first time here. We're doing Palm Sunday, obviously. And this is one of those things. It's actually, I was really struggling. This is a very difficult thing to preach because you've heard so many messages of it. You know, every year you're going to hear a message. And you think everybody knows everything. So I think the temptation is to find some new horse and pony show over here in the corner, something that's never been spoken, and you want to, you know, make it this nuance. But there is so much focus on this, and it's such a linchpin or such a hub, it's such a conjunction of time as it begins Passion Week. And it really is a unique time in the Lord's ministry. And it's where we see so much focus. Every single gospel, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, talk about the triumphal entry, the Palm Sunday, the coronation. This is something that any of the gospels missed.
And I'm going to get a little running start. We're going to look at, I'm going to start off in Matthew 20, verse 17 and 19. And this I found really interesting. I almost want to preach this as an outline for the Passion Week, because it pretty much hits a bunch of notes. Obviously, it's foretelling exactly in great detail what Passion Week is going to look like. And Jesus was going up to Jerusalem. He took 12 disciples aside, the 12 disciples aside, and on the way he said to them, "See, we are going up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man will be delivered over to the chief priests and scribes. They will condemn him to death and deliver them to the Gentiles to be mocked, flogged, crucified, and will be risen and be rise on the third day." So that is the Passion Week. That's pretty much everything that happens. And what's really interesting is we see in this time period there's this big paradigm shift from Jesus kind of behaving secretively and kind of telling people, "Hey, you know, oh, you got healed by me. Well, don't tell anybody." Or, "Oh, you realize I'm the Messiah?" You know, as Peter makes that confession, "You are the Son of God, the Messiah." And Jesus is like, "Hey, you know, this wasn't revealed to you by yourself. God revealed this to you, Peter. And by the way, mum's the word until a certain time." In the Palm Sunday story, it's the exposing and ta-da, here I am. It's a miraculous show of all that's come together in his miracles, in his teaching, and all the prophecies coming together, and he's now letting everybody know, "This is who I am." And so that's what happened. So there really is a unique time in our Lord's life. It's Palm Sunday changes everything. Running up to this time, you've got healing of the blind man in Jericho. So he's coming to Jerusalem, right? But remember, he's in Jericho. He heals the blind man. You have the story of Zacchaeus happening right there. And what's interesting, the two blind men in this episode that is recorded in Matthew, Mark, and Luke, you see primarily that once the two blind men become sighted individuals, they join kind of a progression of individuals from Galilee in the area that's following Jesus around. All the miracles and all the activity is bringing forth an entourage of individuals, more so than the disciples. So quickly after these two blind guys are healed, boom, they join in and they start following Jesus. Zacchaeus is healed, right? "I must dine with you." So once again, this sinner, this enemy of the Israelites is showing grace. And then you basically have, you know, the fact that, you know, Mary sends word to Jesus that her brother Lazarus is sick, you know, "Please come." And he lingers two more days, right? So a complete amount of 4 days that Lazarus is dead. And of course, the raising of Lazarus is remarkable, obviously. It's miraculous. Need I say any more? And it hits the radar to the enemies of Christ, who realize that his popularity and what he's doing on his way to Jerusalem, once again, is turning up the volume of the light, illuminating who he is. Because prior to this, he couldn't really do anything if everybody knew who he was. He couldn't even hardly teach or travel or do anything. So he's keeping it stealth and quiet, right? So he can do and accomplish everything that he's done. So the raising of Lazarus. And remember, there's this great discussion with Martha. "Hey, you know, do you believe in the resurrection?" "Yeah, I believe in the resurrection in the last days." Jesus says, "No, I'm the resurrection and the life." So he's this teaching of who he is that his identity, his illumination is becoming more and more stronger. Then there's the conspiracy council, where primarily the Jewish leaders now plot wholeheartedly with the resurrection of Lazarus. They've had enough. This is going to really undermine all that they've worked for in regards to their temple system, which isn't it's not Judaism any longer, right? We understand that the Jewish leaders during Jesus' time had pretty much morphed what God had started in regards to the sacrificial system into something that didn't even resemble what it was supposed to be pointing to, right? John the Baptist says, "Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world," as he sees Jesus coming two towards and be baptized. That's the linchpin of what their faith is about. It's to point to the atoning sacrifice of what Jesus does on the cross. And this has been left way behind with the money changers and them selling doves and sacrificial things, that it turned into a power grab. The power went to their head, and the Pharisees are no longer representing what Judaism truly was to begin with. Now, obviously, when I make blanket statements like that, there are some of the Pharisees and leaders who had it right and understand it. They're one of many voices, right? But in general, you understand what I'm saying. This whole idea is shipwrecked, right? It's the idea of we see cults come to life in Christianity, where some dynamic leader changes and does a perverted twist on Christianity, and they teach a false gospel. And that's similar to what primarily happened in Judaism. A false representation of what God intended Judaism to be is now in power in Jerusalem. Also, the leaders reject Jesus as a Messiah in Matthew 12. We're going to talk about that a little bit later also. But you have to understand, what happens in Matthew 12 in regards to the leaders is real important as we come up to Palm Sunday. Because what happens there is they accuse Jesus of having the power of Beelzebub, right? And it's the unforgivable sin, right? The blaspheming the Holy Spirit it talks about. And you can clearly see, if you're reading context, the blaspheming the Holy Spirit applies to the Jewish leaders exclusively. It's something that's pretty difficult to do in the here and now, because primarily we have the Holy Spirit as believers, and we have the truth of Scripture from God's Word, and anybody in the here and now that rejects something that they know. Let me re-say this to make sure this is thin ice. We've got to get this right. What the Jewish leaders did was to reject Christ, which they wholeheartedly knew to be the Messiah. It's the rejection of Jesus being the Messiah. And that's something that nobody goes around and does. Because once we know who the Lord Jesus Christ is, right, we're going to follow him. Now, we've maybe heard about the Lord Jesus Christ at times, and coming to knowledge of the Lord. But do we believe? See, it's the same difference. If there's unbelief, then the same is true for you. It's not that you necessarily rejected the whole Holy Spirit and blasphemed against him. You just haven't come to fruition as a believer. Are we all good? This is important to understand, because as Palm Sunday comes together, there's going to be real believers praising him, and then there's going to be people that fear man. People who are there just because this is what the crowd is doing. Peer pressure. And they don't really believe. Plus, in addition to that, they have an agenda. Similar to what the Pharisees. The Pharisees had an agenda, is what they had. And they didn't want to get off their agenda, right? They didn't want Jesus' mission and Jesus' plan and Jesus' will to be done, because they thought they knew better than God. And isn't that true all through Christendom? Isn't that true when Jesus is teaching in John 6? He turns around and says, "My blood is real drink, and my body is real food." And at that time, many departed. Why? Because they didn't want that Jesus. They wanted the free lunch. They came to Jesus for a different reason. Are we tracking? We're all good? This is important stuff to set the scene of what's happening on Palm Sunday, to understand that when we come to the Lord, what we're going to do is we're going to submit to him. And we're going to then turn around and call him the king of our lives. So one of the other things then that happens, of course, is he's anointed in Bethany with Mary at that dinner, right? And if you think about what's happening there, it's this expensive perfume called nard. And it's almost like a burial preparation, right, that we see happening. So these are the things happening on the way to Jerusalem. And the stage is set where basically the Pharisees are in power. They want to kill Jesus. They want to kill Lazarus. And the Passover, Passover celebration, what was the word? The Passover celebration is coming, right? Which is the idea of, you know, in Egypt, right, where the death angel goes over. Sabbath, the Passover Sabbath. I'm sorry, that was the word I was looking for. I'm sorry, I'm getting old and words are slipping away from me nowadays. It's pretty exciting. not exciting. It's humbling. My time has not yet come. That's a theme, once again. It's a theme that we see. My time has not yet come. Matter of fact, you know what? When he's at the wedding with his mother, and it's like, hey, Jesus, time to turn some water into wine. Oh, don't you know my time has not yet come? So Jesus obeys his mom and starts his ministry with that miracle of turning water into wine. But you see this over and over in John 2:4, and Jesus said to her, woman, what has this to do with me? My hour is not yet come. That's in regards to Mary at the wedding in Canaan. John 7:30 says this, so they were seeking to seize him, and no man laid a hand on him because his hour had not yet come. So Jesus talks about this hour, which is pretty much the cross. It's basically his hour to lay down his life. But because his time had not yet come, they couldn't seize him. John 8:20 says, these words were spoken in the treasury as he taught in the temple, but no one arrested him because his hour had not yet come. So you see there's a timing thing that is happening. And once again, there's the secretiveness that he's doing in regards to his identity so he can accomplish all that he needs to accomplish. And now the gloves are off. The illumination of who he is going to be shown to all of Jerusalem. As he comes down from Galilee, there's a collection of disciples and individuals that have seen his healings, seen his ministries. So he shows up with an entourage of committed believers and that are there to celebrate and see what he does over the Passover time period. So I'm going to use the backdrop for our text, Matthew 21. So 21, and here we go. 21 verse 1 through, 11. Now, when they drew near to Jerusalem and came to Bethphage of the Mount of Olives, then Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, go into the village in front of you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, you shall say, the Lord needs them, and he will send them at once. This took place to fulfill what was spoken by the prophet, saying, say to the daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming to you, humble and mounted on a donkey, on a colt, a foal of a beast of burden. The disciples went and did as Jesus directed them. They brought the donkey and colt and put them on and put their cloaks on it, put on their cloaks. He sat on them. Most of the crowd spread their cloaks on the road, and others cut branches from trees and spread them on the road. And the crowds that went before him and that followed him were saying, or shouting for that matter, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed be he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. And when he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred up. Who is this? And the crowd said, this is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth. Heavenly Father, Lord God above, I just thank you and praise you for the free word and how it illuminates us, Lord God. I pray that you'll speak the truth through me, Lord God. I pray that I have good clarity, Lord God, and that people come to an understanding all the more of who you are, Lord God. And we give you the glory on this beautiful Palm Sunday. In your precious Son, Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, so there's this royal procession that starts off. And what's interesting is, over the course of time, there has been these terms given to this day, the triumphal entry, Palm Sunday, coronation, Jesus' coronation, like coronating a king. And it's interesting because all three of these terms kind of hit the mark and missed the mark, if that makes sense. Because in all reality, there is another coronation we'll be talking about here at the end of the message that basically is kind of the real coronation where he really is taking on his kingdom, where he's going to take the reins and rule. And that's what a coronation would point to is a changing of ruling, right? And so these three terms, I mean, Palm Sunday is primarily a nickname given by the early church. That's where that comes from. Coronation is just one of those connections to what is actually happening here in regards to a king taking over power. And the triumphal entry is not so triumphal since, you know, just a few days, they're all going to scream to crucify and crucify and crucify. So it's a real confusing thing to look at in regards to what you call this triumphal entry. I mean, it is definitely an entry, and it's triumphal only because of what he does on the cross. Amen? That's what the triumph is. That this Passion Week is working towards doing that. Now they drew near to Jerusalem and came to Bethage, Mount of Olives. Then the two disciples were sent out and said to them, go to this village. You immediately find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Now, in reality, there's arguments over this because in this passage here, it deals with the donkey and the colt. That basically it's a mom and a baby, right? That's what we're dealing with. This picture right here would maybe be better represented if the mama donkey is being pulled in front, right? If you know mamas and donkeys and how they lead each other, then in all reality, he chose the never ridden smaller beast of burden. But in reality, the image would maybe have the mother walking in front, maybe them two tied together, how that would happen. That was exactly what we're seeing in the text here. Now, some people argue, well, it's a contradiction because the other accounts don't talk about the two individual creatures here. But we can truly see that it makes perfect clarity sense that the mama one could be there. Just a little footnote. Untie them, plural once again, and bring them to me, plural. Once again, showing that there's probably two beasts of burden being brought to Jesus, right? If anyone says anything to you, say, the Lord needs them. Now, this then brings up once again another conclusion or another idea that comes to mind is like, well, who is the owner of this? This looks like thievery. It's like, hey, you're stealing my animals here. But the master needs them, probably denotes that the owner of these donkeys was a believer, was someone that actually her master, he must have understood and knew, because there isn't a big conversation shown here. It's just tell the Lord needs them, and he will send them at once. This took place to fulfill what is spoken of by the prophet, right? And then that's, of course, that's in Zechariah 9:9, and the full passage says this, rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Daughter of Zion is primarily, you know, Zion is one of the nicknames for Jerusalem, so people of Jerusalem, shout aloud, O daughters of Jerusalem. And we definitely see some shoutings coming up. Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. We see some shouting that's going to happen. O daughter of Israel, look, your king comes to you. He is righteous, victorious, humble, and riding on a donkey. On a male donkey, the foal of a female donkey. In great description, the two creatures are described right here, the two donkeys. So you can clearly see that this is probably what it is. And it's just victorious and humble. It's a powerful word picture of his entry into the kingdom. In Luke, we pick up the idea in Luke's account of the Palm Sunday, Luke 36 through 40, it says this, and as he rode along, they spread out their cloaks on the road. As he was drawing near, already on their way down to Mount Olives, the whole multitude of his disciples began to rejoice and praise him with a loud voice. And all of the mighty works that he had seen, all the mighty works that they had seen, saying, blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord, peace in earth and glory in the highest. So we get a report right there that, primarily something loud is happening. It's so loud that it disturbs the Pharisees. Verse 39, it says this, and some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to him, "Teacher, rebuke your disciples." He answered, I tell you, if these were silent, the very stones would cry out. So once again, kind of irritating the Pharisees. And one of the goals, I mean, if you think about what he said, right, you know, first thing I read earlier in the message here, Matthew 20, going back, we're going up to Jerusalem. He took the disciples aside and said on the way, see, we're going to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man must be delivered over to the chief priests and scribes. See, so there has to be an increased bit of angst given to the chief priests and Pharisees to get them to act in a timely manner to crucify him on the Sabbath, right? On the Passover Sabbath. See, this is important to hit that note. Now, and it was one of those things, this isn't anything he has to orchestrate, you know, too much, because the Pharisees and chief priests, they have it so in for them, the hatred and the fact that they realize that they're going to lose their power if Christ is the Messiah, right? But you can see that doing this, and of course, what's he do the very next day? He turns over the money changer tables, remember? So he's really just out pushing his luck. There's no two ways about it. He is bringing forth an angst of the leaders, because in order for salvation to occur, he has to die for the sins of mankind. And all these things have to, they're all just lining up in this Passion Week. It's a pretty exciting time. It's pretty amazing how he orchestrates the will of God being accomplished in this time. Verse 6, the disciples went and did as Jesus directed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and put on their cloaks, and he sat on them. Most of the crowd spread their cloaks on the road, and others cut branches from trees and spread them out on the road. And we pick up in John 12:13 that the branches were palm trees, so that's where we get that fact from, as John shares exactly what kind of tree branches they were. And what we're primarily seeing here is something unique to this culture, and he's speaking more than we can see. Laying the cloaks down in front. Now think about that. You've got your cloak, and you're going to let a donkey walk over it, maybe two donkeys, maybe a bunch of other people until you pick your cloak up. But what the imagery is saying right here is, Lord Jesus, we submit to you. Putting our cloaks down says that we're under your feet. That's the message that the cloaks are bringing. That's what it's saying. It's saying it to the Pharisees in volume, and it's continued to raise their angst against Jesus. And what it's saying to the Lord Jesus Christ is, we are submitted under your feet. Now, the palm branches give another message. What they relay is victory and peace. It's the waving of palm branches when a general or some kind of a conquering, or not conquering, but your army comes back with victory. Now you've secured a peace. The war is over, and you now secured a peace, a victorious peace. That's why the palm branches pretty much say and complete what it says in the passage in regards to Zechariah 9:9. It says, victorious and humble, riding a doctor. He is righteous, victorious and humble, riding a donkey. The palm branches kind of finish off the fulfillment of that passage, if you think about it. The fact that the palm branches are representing that he's victorious. Now, he's really not victorious, of course, until he's crucified and rises from the dead, right? The resurrection is what does complete the saving work of the Lord Jesus Christ. So we see submission, adoration, praise, and having put their hope in Jesus. The part of putting their hope in Jesus shows up in them screaming, Hosanna. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna is a Hebrew word that says save now. In English, literally, Hosanna means I beg you to save, or please deliver us. So Hosanna, we see shows up right here in verse 9. Or, oh, that, where did verse 8 go? Did I read that? Oh, I did read verse 8. Verse 9 says this, and the crowds that went before him and that followed them were shouting, Hosanna to the highest, Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. So this Hosanna term, once again, is a term that directly connects Jesus to the Messiah. Once again, this is a messianic passage pointing to who Jesus Christ is. And then wanting him to save, it's interesting. Similarly, okay, to what I said in regards to John 6, how the massive crowd was there, and they were there for the free meal, right? He just got done feeding 5,000. And then he says, my body is real food, and my blood is real drink. And everybody's like, I'm out of here. I don't like this teaching. And he gets diminished, right? Downsized. Hosanna in the highest, saved now, of course, is a battle cry that the Israelites are hoping that Jesus does to the Romans. They're under an oppressive time. So once again, there's a large portion showing up, but they have an agenda. They have a desire that they want met. Now, Hosanna in the highest, save us. That's great because it points to his messiahship. But what's he saving them from? Their sins. He's going to reconcile them back to the Lord, which is the more important thing to be done by all means. We live under all sorts of political things, you know, capitalism, socialism, communism, oligarchies, fascisms. We're under all sorts of different governmental things. It's not our task to overthrow governments, which is where we're born. That's where we are. Our task as followers of Lord Jesus Christ is to share the gospel and set them free and have them forgiven by the King and the kingdom that will reign forever. Amen? Amen. That's our task. We can get a little tied up in politics here and thinking politics are going to improve our day or improve something. Politics are going to do what politics does. That's what politics does. You know? And usually a political idea is an elite idea that they think is going to be good for you. Matter of fact, you don't know as well as I do, get me into power and I'm going to be this great blessing to you. Matter of fact, the other thing that you see is kind of utopic descriptions of these great regimes. You know, in their mind's eye, if we just do this, and this, everything's going to be equal, everything's going to be loving and fair. Justice shows up in a lot of the governmental narratives because it seems like justice is an important thing. Well, it truly is because we're creating God's likeness. Justice is written on our heart. Justice is something that we desire out of the starting block. I mean, I often talk about baby morality, how kids are making moral choices at an unbelievable young age. And they're quickly saying, that's not fair. And they're quickly interacting with stealing cookies and lying to the parents and feeling guilty, right? That guilty conscience. These are all things that tie to justice. And it's a beautiful gift of God. And we have it because we're in his likeness. God is just. So these political systems are grandiose ideas to fix the world and create a kingdom now that will resolve mankind's fallen nature. But be patient, church. There's no political answer to the problem of man's fallen nature other than what the Lord Jesus Christ has done for us on the cross. That's the problem. I mean, that's the solution. The solution is in humility, say, I can't fix the world, but I'm gonna live for the kingdom to come. That's one of the first messages Jesus says, you know. He says, repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. He's preaching the kingdom before the salvation message that he deals with in regards to the rich young ruler, or in regards to what the epistles deal with. So you're seeing that this is such an important factor to have, that his agenda is this. The Israelites, or the Jewish people, during Palm Sunday, in the back of their mind, when they scream Hosanna in the highest, they are looking for save us now. Did they want their sins forgiven? Nope, that wasn't what was on the cross in their mind. What they wanted was the oppressive Roman government to be overthrown. And as the days go by in Passion Week, they start to realize that that's not Jesus' plan. They start to realize, and that's part of the turning of the tide, where all of a sudden, I love you, Jesus. You're the Messiah. Here, I lay my cloak down before you, and I'm smitten to you. But am I? Am I listening to his teaching? Do I understand what he's actually doing in his first mission trip to earth? And evidently, many didn't. And many were, once again, the fear of man. The fear of man. Going along with the crowd. So many of the people putting their cloaks down and doing and saying what was happening was because of the fear of man and just going with the crowd. How commonplace is that in the church age? Or in your own experiences, how many times do you go along and get along just because everybody's doing it? When in reality, we should have pause and reflection to go, which way is this crowd going? Do I really want to go that direction? And what does the Lord tell me? What's my biblical worldview say in regards to this? And the crowds that went before him and that followed him were shouting, Hosanna, Son of David, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. This of course, is an Old Testament passage, Psalm 118, 26 through 25. It says, save us, we pray, O Lord. O Lord, we pray, give us success. Blessed is he who comes in the name of Yahweh. We are blessed from the house of Yahweh. So the battle cry and the connection is pointing back to an Old Testament identification, kind of a handle of who the Messiah is. But what does he say? The saving issue is not the temporal political system that they find themselves in. There is a true triumphant account in the Bible. Since this triumphal entry is framed wrong by the ones worshiping. And that's really interesting. When you think about worship, we can worship with wrong motives, we can worship with wrong intent, you know, with agendas and different things. You know, we can, you know, one of the things that happens is we can do a bait and switch and we can worship the blessings of God instead of God. Right? We like the stuff, but not necessarily God himself. It's one of the things I noticed that most time when Hollywood does a story that includes heaven, there's always people in heaven, but they never show God or Jesus. It's kind of like, we want heaven, we just hope Jesus isn't really there. Right? That seems to be an attitude that happens because we want the blessings of God and what he gives us through heaven, but do we want him? Because it's the relationship, once again, right? It's the fact that we want Jesus. So there is a triumphal entry, so to speak, in Revelation chapter 7, 9 through 12. And then in this case, the priority and motives are correct. This is something that is glorious to see and understand. So there is a time, because once again, Jesus dies on the cross. He defeats Satan. He defeats death. Amen?
Amen.
But he leaves Satan in charge of the world until he returns and wakes Satan up and throws him into the abyss. So you have to understand that he is the king. He's the Messiah and the king. But there's this interim during the church age that we're still in this world where Satan is in rule, right? But when he starts to get ready in the book of Revelation to come down and take his kingship, or basically he now is going to take his throne and rule the earth on heaven and earth. This is what we see in Revelation 7, 9 through 12. After this I looked, behold, a great multitude that no one could number from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and languages, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed in white robes with palm branches. Ding, 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 ding. Reminiscent of what we're talking about. With palm branches in their hands, once again, victory and peace. And crying out with a loud voice, salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb. Now we're seeing salvation is accomplished, right? So this praise is showing that his kingdomship is going to happen after he accomplished salvation on the cross. Does that make sense? There's an order to this. And unfortunately, the Jewish people during this time pretty much had their priorities moved up. They wanted to be set free from the oppression of the Romans right in the here and now. But what Christ was doing was something completely different that they weren't paying attention to. And let's not be too harsh on them. All through the Gospels, we see that the disciples say, and they didn't understand, they didn't understand, they didn't understand. And this was just another thing they didn't understand till later. Does that make sense? Now, in what he accomplished on the cross, let me just point out very clearly, if you don't understand what it's accomplished there. What's simply accomplished there is a term called substitutionary atonement. That's the big word, but primarily you see this in the Old Testament where God is using a substitute blood sacrifice for a short period of time to cover sin. But Jesus Christ comes, and as I said earlier, behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world, that primarily he is the Lamb of God that's going to be put on the cross, and the sins of mankind are going to be put on him once and for all. The gospel is very simply the fact that Jesus takes your bullet, he takes your electric chair, he takes your death sentence. He receives the punishment that we as sinners deserve. And we are set free when we turn around and trust what Christ did on the cross, which is kind of freeing, right? Jesus said the truth will set you free. You know what's really freeing about this? Is the fact that I don't have to be perfectly good. I don't have to help little ladies across the street all the time and give money to charity and don't lie, steal, or cheat. Now, ideally, those rules have not changed in any manner, shape, or form, and it's great to help little ladies across the street, but I don't do that to earn salvation. Salvation is a free gift. I simply, in humility, say, I'm not good enough. I'll never be good enough, Lord. I'm going to take your son's payment on the cross. Amen?
Amen.
That's the grace of God. It's just that simple. And if you have a guilty conscience, which is a gift from God, if you've ever recalled feeling bad because you've done something wrong, praise God for that gift. Because that gift should help you go to the foot of the cross, kneel down, and say, forgive me, Lord. Forgive me. Because I've missed the mark. I've hurt my parents. I've hurt my family. I've lied. I've cheated. I've become self-centered and selfish, Lord. Forgive me. That's the beautiful thing. The gospel. It's forgiveness. It's not works. It's not trying to outdo each other. It works righteousness. Why do we do good things after we encounter Christ? Our gratitude. Thank you, Lord, for saving me. Thank you, Lord. That's the gospel. Who is Jesus? In verse 10 it says this. And when we entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred up. Who is this? And the crowd said, this is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth of Galilee. It's interesting. Is he a prophet? Certainly, to some degree, and to many degrees, that matter. Jesus comes and he's speaking for God. He is God. That's what a prophet is, someone who speaks for God. So God incarnate certainly is a prophet. He's speaking for himself. But obviously, he's much more than that. And I think if you recall the encounter with the woman at the well going to Samaria, where primarily this lady's like, hey, I see you're a Jew. Hey, I see you're a prophet. Hey, I see you know everything about me. Are you the Messiah? Yes, I am. Boom, she takes off and tells the whole time. Right? She has this great, like, illumination. You're Jewish. You're a prophet. You're the Messiah. Boom. And what's really cool about Samaria, I was just reflecting on this last night, Jesus then goes and spends two days in Samaria with a whole town that's super excited about who he is. And this is an area that he didn't tell them to shut up. You know, shh, mom's word, I'm the Messiah, right? And I think the reason he didn't have to do that is because the Samaritans had such a turmoilous, pretty much non-existent relationship with the Jewish people. They avoided them as unclean, right? Their prejudice towards the Samaritans kept them kind of in a bubble where Jesus could enjoy being who he was with the Samaritans for 2 days. Because they figured out who he was and they weren't going to tell the Jews. They weren't going to talk. And I found that kind of delightful. I think that would have been a delightful time for the Lord in Samaria, where they know who he is and he's kind of out of the closet. And, hey, you guys know who I am? You can now worship me, which maybe occurred. We don't have much details. these are all assumptions, but I think that was probably a delightful time for the Lord. Who is this? Who is this? As I mentioned earlier, the Jewish leaders know who he is. In Matthew 12, we see the clear rejection of the Messiahship based on power. And it's really sad because in the church age, there's people that have a really strong inkling who Jesus is, but they like, you know, they like to suppress the truth in unrighteousness, what it says in Romans, the fact that they like their sin so much. Jesus talks about light is coming to the world, but because man likes darkness, they run from the light. They like their sin. They have a passionate desire to keep sinning, really. In Matthew 23, this is, of course, we're reading in Matthew 21. In Matthew 23 is recorded a conversation with the Pharisees. And what happens here is there's six woes. Woe, Pharisees, you know, you whitewash tombs. You wash out the inside of the bowl, wash out the outside of the bowl, and inside is just filthy and disgusting. And you make a new convert, you make him twice the resident of hell because of what you're teaching and doing. So these six woes he's teaching. Once again, in Passion Week, he turns over the tables on the first day, and the next day he's teaching in the synagogue. He just takes over the temple, and he starts teaching there, big crowds. And he rebukes the Pharisees, woe, 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 woe. And in Matthew, in the last part of that, in 23, Matthew 37 through 39, it says, O Jerusalem, O Jerusalem, the city that kills the prophets and stones those who are sent to it, how often would I gather your children together as a hen gathers her brood under her wings, and you were not willing. See, your house is left to you desolate. For I tell you, you will not see me again until you say, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Once again, that's that messianic title. So this is the same statement that said a few days prior, right, Palm Sunday. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Once again, a messianic title. Now, remember, you've got the blaspheme against the Holy Spirit in chapter 12, Matthew, clearly explained that they knew who he was, but they rejected him. That's just so premeditated that it's unforgivable. Then, of course, you have Jesus talking about destroying the temple, right? In 3 days of rising again, of course, referring to his resurrection, but talking about in 70 AD the destruction of Jerusalem. So what happens to the Jewish nation? It's destroyed in 70 AD. Why? The rejection of his messiahship. And he will not return until they say, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Until they say it and mean it in regards to who he is and acknowledging his messiahship. This generation is the term used in Matthew 12. This generation, this generation, this generation. Really referring to the Jewish leaders of that time had blown it for all of Israel at that time. They're going to go silent, right, and dispersed for a ton of years until, matter of fact, 1947, 1948, when the Israeli state comes back. Once again, preparing for his second return, the second coming of the Lord. And they're not going to come back until they acknowledge that he is the Messiah, his identity once again. And Hosea says this, I will return again to my place until they acknowledge their guilt and seek my face, and in their distress earnestly seek me. I'm going to return to my place. Let's go back up in heaven. Just going to kick back and wait till the Jewish people acknowledge who he is. Till they acknowledge their guilt and seek my face. In Zechariah 12, 10, it says this, and I will pour out on the house of David and all the inhabitants of Jerusalem a spirit of grace and supplication. They will look on me, the one they have pierced, and they will mourn for him as one mourns for an only child. and grieve bitterly for him as one who grieves for a firstborn son. Zechariah's foretelling a time when they suddenly look upon the Lord and realize he's the Messiah that we bears, and they're going to mourn bitterly. Repentance and a changed heart in Israel will happen. All based on, once again, the fact that they're finally acknowledged that he is the Messiah. Zechariah 13, 8 and 9 says this: "In the whole land, declares the Lord, two-thirds shall be cut off." So now we're talking the tribulation. Now, obviously, I don't think I merged these two because I'm teaching Revelation. Guys? Yeah, I think this is relevant. I think it's really relevant is the fact that primarily what's happening here is blessed be him who comes in the name of the Lord isn't going to occur until all of these prophecies are fulfilled. And the Lord comes and finally, victoriously, miraculously saves the Israelites. But it's not until going through the seven-year tribulation that two-thirds of the Israelites are killed at that time. Every living Jew during the time of the tribulation, two-thirds aren't going to make it through the 7 years. And clearly you can see that right here. Two-thirds are cut off and perish, and one-third will be left. And I will put this one-third into the fire and refine them as one refines silver and test them as gold is tested. They will call upon my name and I will answer them and I will say, they are my people, and they will say, the Lord is my God. The calling is finally in a desperate state. They finally acknowledge that he is the Messiah at the very end. And then Romans 11:15, you see this. Then the seventh angel blew a trumpet, and there was a loud voices in heaven saying, the kingdom of the world has become our kingdom, and the Lord. Let me read this one. The seventh angel will blow a trumpet, and there will be a loud voice in heaven saying, the kingdom of this world has become the kingdom of our Lord and his Christ, and he shall reign forever and ever. Amen. So this is when he takes on the kingship. You got that? This is where he finally, the triumphal entry, you know, receiving a king, right? This is when it actually occurs in Revelation. And how he accomplished that, Revelation 19:11, it says this: Then I saw in heaven open up, and behold, a white horse. The one sitting on it is called Faithful and True, and in righteousness he judges and makes war. That is Christ's reentrance on the white horse to save Israel, who's called out and said, Blessed be he who comes in the name of the Lord. Any questions? Did I try to make too many points? I know most people want a 3-point sermon and a prayer, but
you might want to plan out. You mentioned Zechariah, it's just interesting. I was thinking while you were speaking of all the prophets prior to his triumphal entry that predicted that, Daniel being one. Given the exact amount of days by the angel Gabriel in the book of Daniel, right to the day
that
he would be first called king. Just interesting stuff all through, because the whole Old Testament points to that.
There's more in the Old Testament than meets the eye. I'm amazed at how much is pointing to the millennial reign of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. And Mike alludes to Daniel, where it talks about the 69 weeks. The 69 weeks, which is just a measurement of time, primarily it starts with Artaxerxes, is when it starts, the 69 weeks, and then the 69 weeks, and these are weeks of years, weeks of days, no, weeks of each week is a year, right?
Yes.
Anyway, but check this out, the 69 weeks end miraculously on the day that the Lord Jesus Christ is cut off. That's the word that God is cut off, the Messiah is cut off, and that of course is the crucifixion. So you got 69 days of weeks, or weeks of days, forgive me, I'm twisting that around, but nonetheless that ends on his crucifixion. And then the 70th week doesn't start until the Antichrist strikes a peace deal with Israel, right? And then we see the Antichrist has 7 years to reign. All right, folks, God bless you. I hope you enjoy the rest of your Palm Sunday. Let's thank the Lord in prayer.
Wow, Guy, I gave you 10 minutes. You want to do like five songs?
Five songs.
That's good.
Heavenly Father, Lord God above, I just thank you and praise you, Lord God. I praise you so much for the illumination of your word, how much you tell us, Lord God. It's overwhelming. Sometimes I desire to say too much, Lord. I'm so encouraged by how you've called us into the kingdom, how you've enlisted us with the Great Commission to do your work here, Lord God, how we are the means to advance your kingdom through setting people free and sharing the gospel message, Lord God. So help us never to lose that fact, Lord God, that as political ideas come and go, Lord God, that it is actually our call to just be faithful and true, to loving our neighbor, loving you, and setting the captives free through telling a story of the love that you've done on the cross for us, the act of love on the cross which set us free, Lord God. I'll never grow tired of telling that story, Lord God. Help us never to grow weary of sharing the goodness of what you've done. In your precious Son, Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Please rise. This next song is called Because He Lives. And if any of you haven't been to a Baptist church in 1976, you're about to be. You know, some of us miss it. 1, 2, 3, 4. God sent his Son, they called him Jesus, he came to love. Thank you. It gives me chills because I remember those days too. All right. Well, we are going to see you guys Friday. We would love to see you guys come in and for Good Friday, and then Easter is next week, Resurrection Sunday. So we'll see you then. Have a great Sunday. Thanks.